My name is Kevin Pierce with Xfo. And today I'm gonna talk about coupling your OTDR settings. So this will be a quick little video. It's one that I've wanted to put together for some time now. And it's really important to understand the importance of this. Coupling your different wavelengths, 1310 and 1550, to the exact same settings. This could be detrimental to your results. And so to kind of put that into some perspective here, there's a little bit of a primer that we need, or a little bit of understanding here. So let me get my big mug out of the way here. And so basically, and we've talked about this in my other videos that talk about OTDR theory. So I'll link those videos in the comments. But essentially, OTDR have several important settings. One of the most important ones is pulse width. So pulse width is the length of the individual pulse that the OTDR sends out. The shorter the pulse width, the better resolution we have. So the closer two events can be, that we can separate and measure them independently. But at the same time, that's also lower power, so we can't test very far. So if we need to test further or through more loss, we need to increase our pulse width. So a 5 nanosecond pulse width is very low resolution, so we can see two events that are 20 meters apart, right? But we cannot test very far. If I up this to say 275 nanoseconds, I can test further, but I lose resolution because my sampling or my pulse width is longer and longer and longer. So all of a sudden I can't measure two events that are 20 meters apart. And so that's a sacrifice you made. So that's point number one that we need to remember. Point number two that we need to remember is that, you know, wavelengths have different attenuation profiles going across your fiber. And so loss coefficient or loss per kilometer. So at 1310, depending on your fiber type, so this will vary. So 1310 nanometers is a shorter wavelength. It has roughly 0.33 dB of loss per kilometer in that range, right? So for every kilometer, we're losing somewhere between 0.3, 0.35 dB of loss. 1550, which is a longer wavelength, suffers from less attenuation. So we're usually about 0.19 to 0.2 dB of loss per kilometer. So as you can see, 1550 has less issues with attenuation. So if I have a 100 kilometer span, at 1310, this would be roughly 33 dB of loss. And at 1550, it would be approximately 20 dB of loss. So that's a huge difference, 13 dB difference. Remember, pulse width equals power. So for me to be able to test through more loss, I need higher pulse widths, which means less resolution. So keep that in mind as we talk about this now. Now let's go to the OTDR here. So I have an FTB X730C plugged in. And by default, if you go down here to the very bottom right here, see this little setting here? We'll go ahead and click that. And you'll see in here, by factory default, we couple the wavelengths. So there's a setting right here that says apply settings by wavelength. It's unchecked. So we're not setting it by wavelength, we're just grouping it all together. So that means whatever pulse width and duration that I use for 1310, I also must use for 1550 because they're coupled at this point. Let's see what happens when we do that. So let me go ahead and get back over to here. And so I'm gonna use auto mode, and I've talked about what auto mode does within our videos. So, I don't need to cover that, but basically we're gonna auto to say 15 seconds. And I'm gonna hit auto here. So the OTDR is gonna decide what is the best pulse width to use at 1310 and 1550 based on a 50 second test. So I'm gonna go ahead and start and then let it run its course. And so you'll see it'll start to adjust. These knobs will go from gray to available. So the first wavelength we're testing here is 1310 or 1550 rather, and it's using 275 nanoseconds. I did a video called Validating a Trace. So I'm looking at it, I'm shooting good launch window. Yeah, I'm sitting about 10 dB above my noise floor, so that's pretty good. And then now here is 1310 and it's using the same settings. See? That's why we don't couple, because 1310 and 1550 are gonna use the same settings, because we told it with the OTDR software to do that. The plus side to doing this is there's less complexity, So when you adjust one, you adjust the other. That way, you know, you don't forget when you do one or the other. But it also has its own complications, right? So if you look at this event table, I want you to pay attention here to event number 7. Event number 7 at 1550 is a fail. Look at that. 1 dB of loss at event number 7. If I go to 1310, it should be slightly higher because remember, 1310 has more attenuation. 1310 is 1.2. So they both fail for this splice because I have the settings coupled. Let me go in here and uncouple the settings. I'm gonna go back down here to the settings down here in the bottom right, right? I'm gonna go ahead and check this button here. Apply settings by wavelength. And so it's actually checked, but VNC is sometimes delayed and it doesn't show it. So if I get out of here and come back, you'll see it. Going over my network, for some reason, the check marks get delayed. It's weird. So now I'm gonna have an independent. The wavelength's now independent. So if I go in here and if I change 1550, you'll notice that 1310 does not change along with it. Where if I have them coupled here, when I change one, it changes the other. That's not what we want if we want to do precise fault isolation. So I'm going to go ahead and re-click that. I'm going to go in here and I'm going to independently set these. So we're still going to do a 15-second test. I'm still going to auto, but it's going to auto them individually. So I'm going to go ahead and hit start average. And 1550 before was doing 275 nanoseconds. That's what it used when I autoed up to it. And just in just case you know, there, you know what I've got up here. It's the start button that I'm hitting up here. So I apologize. I was covering that. So you notice now 1550 uses 100 nanoseconds. Instead of 275. And then 1310 will use 275. When the pulse widths are coupled, 1550 is forced to use a pulse width that 1310 has to use. And 1310 needs a longer pulse width because it has more loss. So, you know, that's what happens here. So in this example here, because the test time is so short, you see we still have one event. But let me do something here. I'm gonna increase the test time to 30 seconds. I wanted to see if it'll do it at 15 just for the sake of speed, but let's do 30 seconds. Let's auto and let's start the averaging again and then see what happens here. So it's gonna run through and then determine what it thinks the best pulse width is. Now at 1550, it said, you know what? If you give me 30 seconds of time to clean up noise, I can use 50 nanosecond pulse width, better resolution. This is where time really becomes important. As you increase your duration, you can use better and better pulse width, shorter and shorter pulse width. So now that I've bumped the averaging time to, or the duration time up to 30 seconds, I can get away with 50 nanoseconds at 1550. And then at 1310, once this is done, we'll see what 1310 likes. And so 1310 likes 100 nanoseconds now. And if you notice, our noise floor has improved tremendously. So once this is done, I'll show it. But with the earlier test, because it was so fast, we had about 5 dB of noise floor, which is decent. But now we're even lower than that. So you can see this here. So let's go over here to 1310. So 1310, I'm going to go to this event here. I still have my 1.2 dB. So you can see in here, at event number 8, I have 1.2 dB. I had 1 dB at 1550 earlier. And so what does that mean? Do I have to do a truck roll to go out here to fix this? I don't know, maybe. But I'm not getting the best results. Let's go to 1550 now. I'm gonna go over here, hit this button, go to 1550. Look at this, I got two events. Check it out. Let me zoom into that. There are two events very close to each other. Look at that. Two events very close to each other. And remember, if you added them up, it was roughly 1 dB. Look at this. One event here has 0.47 dB. This one at here has 0.53 dB. What was the loss when I was using a longer pulse width at 1550? For this entire area, it was 1 dB roughly. So now we have two events that are 0.4 dB and 0.5 dB rather than one event at 1 dB. This is what happens, and it's a consequence of coupling 1310 with 1550. Because 1310 is so lossy, it will often require a larger pulse width. The longer the span, the worse it gets. And if you couple 1550 to 1310, you're doing yourself a disservice because you're not using optimized pulse widths and resolutions. So do yourself a favor and learn how to decouple them. Yes, it adds some complexities because now you have to make sure, you know, if you do a lot of manual measurements, that you're adjusting both of them at the same time, one after another. But at the end of the day, you'll get results that are better. And so in this case here, you know, we went from one really bad event to two events that are all right. The attenuation can be lower for a splice, but they're actually all right. Much better than a 1 dB single event, right? And so that's really it in a nutshell. You know, I didn't want to, you know, really just overspeak it. I just wanted to do a quick little video to kind of show you the importance of decoupling your wavelengths. So, you know, by doing this, you'll be able to see more information, see more relevant information, and be able to troubleshoot your network a little bit more accurately and hopefully improve your MTTR, which is mean time to restore or mean time to repair, and like I said, get better results. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. My name is Kevin Pieris. Thank you very much. We'll be right back.